So I'm really honored to moderate the panel discussion over here with the respected panelists. I hope all of the invited panelists are here. Dr. Chandrasekhar, Dr. Faik, Dr. Radhika, Dr. Sanath, Dr. Stalin. Okay, so already we are running out of time. Start the session. So I have some clinical scenarios here given to me. I'll be discussing case by case. I would like to ask Dr. Chandrasekhar the first case. This is a 70-year-old male, diagnosed case of CLL, mild anemia, and TLC of 46,000 and mild thrombocytopenia. Generalized lymphadenopathy, and further evaluation is the comorbidities of dehydrated cardiac disease and hypertension and hyperlipidemia. Cytogenetic evaluation showed trisomy 12. He was started on chemoimmunotherapy. So 1 year later, he had meaningful response and improved clinical improvement. But somehow he has visited other hematologists and somehow he got for again FISH again, and it shows 17p deletion. First question is, how will you manage the patient now? So patient with the overall meaningful response and is asymptomatic now, and the FISH shows 17 period.
Hi, Karun. Hi,
Karun. Please go on.
Thank you, Dr. Prasad, giving me this opportunity. Karun, I think he has and he is absolutely, he's responded well now.
Yeah, he has a good response.
Anyway, he is recently, after 1 year, he has detected to have deletion 17. But according to guidelines, and it is clear that when there is no indication for treatment, when there is no active disease, I don't think so he requires treatment as of now. I don't know. I think we have to evaluate his routine parameters, all those CBCs and remaining.
We want to treat only if symptomatic, right?
Pardon?
No. You want to treat if he becomes symptom, if he develops symptoms.
Yeah, if he develops symptoms, if he develops active disease, we need to treat him. He is having history of CABG and hypertension. He must have an antiplatelets and a hypertension. Chances of bleeding are there.
So do you want to closely monitor this patient? And
brutally be difficult in. I didn't get you.
Yeah, please complete 10 seconds. Once you complete, then I'll ask.
Yeah. So initially, I'll monitor this case, and if he requires treatment, maybe if I have patient fit, I'll go with Ecallantide.
Fair. So I'll also do the same. I'll monitor this patient closely. Once he start developing symptoms or any signs of active disease, then we'll provide the treatment.
Yes.
Cytogenetic change per se, there is no indication for treatment. Okay. The second question. So will you start, suppose say this patient has symptoms.
Yeah.
What therapy will you choose? Will you start BTK immediately?
If he develops symptoms, I think as he received chemoimmunotherapy and it is more than 1 year and he is having a 17p deletion, so he requires BTK inhibitors, and we need to select the BTK which is better for his present situation. And another option would be venetoclax best. We need to find out finances here at my center, as I am working in a center where we mostly depends on the government schemes. So theoretically, Ecallantide and our venetoclax-based therapies would be better in this case, as he is on antiplatelets. He must have an antiplatelet, CABG, and hypertension.
you are worried about cardiac side effects, right?
Yes.
So you already told that in case asymptomatic, we're going to just wait and watch. Okay, I'll complete the case here.
Yes.
So these are the International Working Group CLL guidelines when to initiate treatment. So we all agree that. So when the patient has symptoms or active disease, we usually think of treatment, irrespective of the cytogenetic aberration or changes for the patient. So this is the chart showing the ESMO guidelines. Again, here it starts, the algorithm starts with the patient if he's symptomatic. And based on the genetic mutation, we go ahead. So because of short of time, I'll not be taking much discussion here. We'll go to second case. This question is to Dr. Faik Ahmed, Senior Consultant Pathologist.
Yeah.
Sir has already has clearly, very beautifully explained about the genetics part in his slides. Just to brush out, this is the case, sir. 74-year-old male, 74-year-old patient presents with cervical lymphadenopathy with comorbidities like mentioned here, extensive bulky nodes. He has mild thrombocytopenia, otherwise mild anemia. In case of CLL, and the bulky nodes 12 centimeter, and FISH testing reveals deletion 11q, and IgHV is unmutated. But to you, this is just a case scenario, and sir, this is out of your practice. The first question is, sir, how commonly do you get to see IgHV test being recommended by hematologist or oncologist?
I would say that, you know, that practice is still not there. Very occasionally, we have been asked for this IgVHD test, but it is not that frequent.
Agreed. So even in my center and in my practice, I routinely do cytogenetics and FISH. Usually, we stop at the level of IgHV because of the finances and the turnaround time and so many other things. And the second question, sir, would you perform panel of tests together or would you employ a sequence to the testing pattern to identify the patient early? I agree that the test you perform will be decided by the physician who is asking the test. Otherwise, how is it in your center? Are you doing the panel of tests together or are you doing running a reflex panel sort of thing?
Actually, upfront, we have a panel for any patient who has been diagnosed with CLL. Once we are through and confirmed by phenotyping that we are dealing with CLL, we have a panel which is called as a CLL comprehensive panel, where we do the FISH testing and subsequently the cytogenetic analysis is carried out in these patients. And mutation analysis, as I was telling, that it's very rare. But otherwise, upfront, in majority of the cases who are paying kind, because, you know, once you have a financial constraint, these tests become quite cumbersome for patients. So once they are sure that this patient is having CLL, definitely we have the sequence of events where we first get a panel of FISH done and then cytogenetic analysis being carried out.
Yeah, I agree, sir. There are financial limitations is a major concern where we hesitate to order the test. Do you see merit in performing IgHV through, is there any difference, sir, Sanger sequencing or the NGS?
Yeah.
Already you have explained in your slides.
Exactly.
Can you brief it?
Yeah, what happens usually, you know, the limit of detection plays an important role in case of detecting this IgVH mutation analysis. Around 10 to 20% of mutant alleles which are there can be missed by means of Sanger sequencing. So it is important that, you know, if we move ahead to doing by NGS, it will be a better platform. But if still, if it is not there, I think IgHV can be carried out by means of Sanger sequencing.
Yeah, agree, sir. Thank you. Thanks for the information. So we'll go ahead with the next scenario. I need not go through all this because it's already covered. This is scenario three. This case goes to Dr. Radhika. She's the consultant hematologist in NIMS. Dr. Radhika, this is your case. He's a 54-year-old male, known case of B-cell ALL, very active person. No cytopenias. Lymphadenopathy, beta-2 microglobulin is mildly elevated, bone marrow, 80% lymphocytes, IgHV mutated, but has deletion 17P positive. So this is the scenario, asymptomatic CLL patient with 17P deletion.
Thank you, Dr. Karun. Thank you, organizers.
How will you manage?
So this is a 54 years old man.
Dr. Radhika, your voice is not audible. Not clear.
Is it clear now?
Yeah, no, better.
It's good? Okay, sure. So this is a 44 years old man, active, great going patient, based on the information you have provided, he fits into an asymptomatic early stage disease, right? Yes. As far as CLL-IPS4 is considered, he gets a score of 5. His T53 mutation scores him 4. His IGH3 mutated 0 score. Beta 2 microglobulin less than 3.50. RAI1 BNAT scores him 1 point. Age less than 65 years scores him 0. So overall, the IPA-CLL score is around 5. That fits him into a high-risk CLL. So the treatment would be treat unless the patient is asymptomatic. So generally, patients with asymptomatic CLL, we use wait and watch policy. So the same applies for this patient too. The test result, whatever the T53 IGH3 mutation, wouldn't change any kind of treatment strategies here. The rationale for obtaining all these prognostic markers would be for prognostic value, but otherwise it would not change any kind of treatment strategies here. So I would like to follow a wait and watch policy for this patient. I would like to get the baseline genomics P53 and IGH3 mutation here, because that will help me in giving an information to the patient about the future likelihood of the future progression of the disease. And also it would give me some information about what could be the likely treatment strategies if the patient progresses on this disease. So that is why I would like to go ahead with all these prognostic markers at presentation, but it would not in any way change my treatment strategies. The treatment is going to be wait and watch policy for an asymptomatic early stage CLL.
This is a repetition. So basically, we are going to treat active and symptomatic patient or patient with an active disease, irrespective of the cytogenetic.
Yeah. Okay.
So this is a table showing the similar decision-making process. So where basically we consider treatment in a patient who has an active disease or we can see a high stage 3-4 high risk disease. And so depending, we take decision based on the mutation status and the fitness. So combining these, we decide choice of therapy in this case. Okay, this is case scenario 4. This is for Dr. Stalin Chaudhary Bala, medical oncologist, NIMS Hyderabad. Dr. Stalin?
Yeah, good evening.
Hi. This is your case. 74-year-old female, known case of BCL-ALL, deletion 11-2, IGHV status unknown. She has received 3 cycles of bendamustine rituximab, discontinued due to toxicity. She had developed severe nausea and diarrhea. She couldn't continue treatment. Stopped treatment in between. And presents to clinic again after 3 months with complaints of these symptoms. Night sweats, fever, weight loss. For further evaluation, she has cytopenia, she has anemia, she has thrombocytopenia and TLC count of 55. And diabetic since 20. So here, the question to you is, Dr. Bala, what additional diagnostic tests we will recommend in this scenario? So we have here IGHV, we don't know IGHV status, otherwise we have FISH showing deletion 11-2 and we have hemogram here.
Yeah, I will repeat the entire CLL panel again, especially the 17P, because we had some data that even though 17P is not a presented diagnosis, it can be acquired at relapse or acquired during the process of the disease progression. So I will repeat it. And the IGHV status, it is initially unknown, and I will do the IGHV status now. So coming to other investigations, she had a bicytopenia, and possibly I'm thinking that it could be because of CLL. But before starting the treatment, I will exclude that it is not autoimmune related, which can happen in a case of CLL.
So will you reach out in this patient?
No, definitely no. For a 74-year-old female, so who suffered a lot with the previous chemotherapy, who were able to tolerate only 3 cycles of bendamustine rituximab, definitely I am not going to re-challenge her with the chemoimmunotherapy. And if I consider the BTK inhibitor, definitely I will go with acalabrutinib in this case, because she had a profuse diarrhea with the previous chemotherapy. And we know from the data that the acalabrutinib is well tolerated and had a less incidence of diarrhea compared to the ibrutinib. And also the platelet count is somewhat worrisome here, that she had a thrombocytopenia. We know that the thrombocytopenia is much more common, and decreased platelet counts are more commonly seen with ibrutinib compared to the acalabrutinib. Taking her age into account, presentation with the thrombocytopenia, previous diarrhea history, a BTK inhibitor is the choice of them. I preferably choose acalabrutinib in her.
Yeah, agreed. So this is next case scenario. This is for Dr. Sanath, medical oncologist, Basavatharakam. So Dr. Sanath?
Hello, hi.
Hi, Dr. Sanath. This is 30-year-old young CLL, case of young CLL. Experiences a very rapid elevation in peripheral blood lymphocyte numbers, which increased from 20,000 at baseline to 2 lakh within his first year. Spleen is very large and palpable, occupying the massive spleen. So he has no notable lymphadenopathy. This patient's prognostic markers indicate an unfavorable prognosis. He has unmutated IGHP as well as trisomy 12, and he does not have deletion 17. So young CLL patient, rapidly progressing disease and an unfavorable genotype. So how will you manage this?
So he is young, fit, and he is symptomatic because of a large splenomegaly, and he has a unfavorable risk because of IGHV unmutated. So I will discuss the options of acalabrutinib plus obinutuzumab or acalabrutinib. If he is not, if the affordability is issue, then ibrutinib, single agent ibrutinib.
Okay. So I have financial decides the management here between acalabrutinib and ibrutinib. Would you consider finite treatment or treatment till progression?
So this I will discuss with the patient. This I will discuss with the patient. Another option we can give if he wants finite treatment, then we can go with the venetoclax and obinutuzumab regimen. So in which 12 months treatment is enough. So I will discuss with them. But the problem with the venetoclax and obinutuzumab is it's toxicity. So it is somewhat toxic regimen. So I will discuss with the patient and then I will.
So you will consider a finite treatment if he agrees and the finances are okay.
But mostly I will go with if he asks that, if he decides, if he go with my decision, then I will go treatment till progression, because we think that CLL is a incurable disease. So if he gives option to me, mostly I will go with treatment till progression.
Okay. So if you have an option of chemoimmunotherapy and BTK inhibitors or BCL2, what would be your choice? And I think you have already answered this question. Your choice would be venetoclax and obinutuzumab. Second is BTK, right?
Yes. And because with BCL2 and obinutuzumab, the MRD, we will achieve MRD at a high, more.
MRD negative is possible with venetoclax.
So, though the side effects are high, so I will discuss with the patient and I will go.
So, do you consider stem cell transplant for this patient?
At this point, no.
So, how do you plan therapy in these patients? Usually, chemoimmunotherapy versus targeted therapies. Usually, targeted therapies, the purpose is to keep the disease in control, and these are usually continued for lifetime, for longer time. Whereas chemoimmunotherapy, the goal of therapy is eradication, like FCR and VR therapy. And we decide on multiple features like fitness and genetic profile into consideration before we decide therapy. So this is a flow chart I have taken from one of the blood articles 2018 by John Griffin. Here, there are few factors which favors allo transplant in people, especially if you look at the age, the younger age and no comorbidity and well-matched donor is one of the criteria, and higher disease risk, complex karyotype, high risk cytogenetics, MRD positivity, shorter duration of response, digital transformation, refractory to chemoimmunotherapy, refractory to BTK inhibitors or novel therapies. So these are the patients where we consider transplant. Suppose as Dr. Sanath mentioned, stem cell transplant is not an option at this point. Suppose the patient becomes refractory to therapy later, definitely this is an option. So do you have time? So this is the last case. I'll close with this case. This is a 72-year-old man with active lifestyle, diagnosed BCLL stage 1, minimal palpable adenopathy. 5 years after his diagnosis, he has bulky adenopathy, progressive larger lymph nodes, the cervical and axillary area, no clinically palpable spleen, TLC of 45,000, deletion 11Q in FISH, 6 cycles of VR he was received. And treatment stopped when all of the clinically visible diseases are disappeared. He received a finite treatment. is tolerated well. The blood deposits were reduced between 800 to 1000 by 4 months after the last BR cycle. And his HP and platelet normalized. So now almost 8 years he was doing fine. Now he's become 80-year-old. He started to exhibit signs of bulky adenoma. So again, there is a growth in lymph nodes. So at this point, so this question is for Dr. Chandrasekhar. Prognostic markers you will prefer in relapsed refractory patients. So here, so we have FISH showing deletion 11q. Other than that, we don't have any other information. So what are the
other? Yes, according to as Dr. Stalin said, CLL patients can acquire the mutations at relapse when they are progressing. So I repeat the FISH again to look for any 17q deletions are there or not. If possible, TP53. And I don't think so. IGH mutation they have done here.
They're not
accomplished. These are for completion sake. We should repeat the prognostic markers again.
You will repeat FISH and you will also ask for IGHV status, right?
Mostly finances are okay.
Yeah. Agree. So, Dr. Radhika, which regimen do you most often use in patients with relapsed refractory CLL?
Yeah, sure. In continuation with Dr. Chandrasekhar, I would get FISH for prognostication. So, because if he turns out to be a high risk CLL, or if his P53 is positive, then obviously I would like to go for the latest targeted therapies like BTKI inhibitors, either the first generation or second generation acalabrutinib is my treatment of choice. Patient financially good, venetoclax plus minus obeticholic, whatever the drug, whatever has been referred in the previous by this previous speakers can be considered yours. So the regimens to be considered are BTK inhibitors, ibrutinib, acalabrutinib, or BCL2 inhibitors like venetoclax plus minus an anti-CD20 is the preferred regimen of choice. But because the patient has relapsed more than 3 years after attaining a response to the previous, after chemoimmunotherapy, it's 3 years, I suppose, right? From asymptomatic, after 5 years, he became symptomatic. From symptomatic, he relapsed after 3 years. So if the genomic profile shows a low-risk CLL, maybe you can also re-challenge the patient with a repeat chemoimmunotherapy too. That's obviously the second option, not the primary option.
Agree with you. The regimen which we choose basically depends on the type of therapy, what the patient has received earlier, and the duration of the relapse, when it happened after the response, and the mutation. So these are the three things which we take into account when we decide on therapy. So Dr. Stalin, what factor influences your choice of therapy? Again, I think we are repeating the same thing.
Yeah, the same thing. If at all the prognostic markers are present, they can influence the therapy now. And of all major thing is the, because she is a 72-year-old female, the tolerability to the previous chemotherapy and also her performance status at this relapse will decide the therapy. But whatever it is, the most probably at this age with a relapsed CLL, the most effective therapy is an oral therapy, that is either ibrutinib or acalabrutinib, taking her past history into consideration and her age. So possibly a BTK inhibitor is the treatment of choice for her.
I think age-wise, yeah, BTK would be a better choice. I agree. Dr. Sanath, what is your treatment goal in elderly frail patients with CLL? Again, I think more or less same question.
Good palliation. Palliation of symptoms, mainly.
Okay. So what do you use in these patients?
So same, it depends upon FISH, it depends upon repeating the cytogenetics. So if there is same, if there are high risk, then depend mostly I will go with acalabrutinib after discussing. If they are of low risk and low risk, then I will try to use single agent rituximab or bendamustine rituximab.
Agree, we'll go with the patient's performance status and finances. And then finally, we also discuss with the patients finally, and we also should respect what they want overall perspective. So here ends the discussion, and thank you each and every panelist for participating. Thanks for the organizers for honoring me by moderating this session. Thank you.